Hey everybody, welcome to my channel. Today I have some really exciting content for you that I have been in the process of arranging over the past couple weeks. Previously on this channel, I did an interview with my friend Abby called Archaeologists in the Pub, which you may want to check out. It'll be linked down in the description below. And today I'm interviewing another really exciting person on my channel. I'm really pleased to welcome and speak to Jeanette Plummer Sires, who is a fellow archaeologist who is living and working in the heritage profession in the UK. After receiving her undergraduate in classical archaeology and anthropology from the City University of New York, she moved to the UK to obtain a Master's of Science degree in human osteoarchaeology, sound familiar, from the University of Sheffield. Upon finishing school, she worked as a professional archaeologist for varying companies throughout England and Wales for 5 years. She then worked in heritage consultancy for a time, and recently she made another transition into the world of museums when she was hired at the British Museum as a project archaeologist for archaeological assemblages. In addition to her professional British archaeological experience, she has extensive international research archaeological experience in places like Iceland, Antigua, and Barbuda. In this video today, we are going to be chatting about her studies and her career, where it's taken her, especially about her leap that she's made from archaeological fieldwork into museums. So without further ado, let's get to the interview.
Hey everybody, welcome, and especially welcome today to Jeanette, who is joining us from London and is a heritage professional and archaeologist working here in the UK. So hello, Jeanette.
Hey, Rachel. Thank you for having me.
Thank you for coming on. I'm so happy to have you here. My first question is, what inspired you to study archaeology just in general or at the university level?
I've always had a passion for the ancient world. I've always been fascinated about ancient cultures, what languages they spoke, what food they ate, what gods they worshipped. Mm-hmm. And pretty much as soon as I realized that archaeologists are the ones that attempt to answer those questions, I was set that that's what I wanted to become. And I'm pretty sure I made that decision at around the age of 8. I was very lucky that I was in the States for my university career, because I didn't actually have any mentors or resources like this channel, for example, that really helped me You're welcome. Well, it's true. Just, I didn't necessarily have an understanding of what a career in archaeology would look like. I think I assumed it was strictly academic, that the only option would be to be in academia. So when I chose Hunter College in City University of New York, I did so because I knew, first, I wouldn't have to declare a major until my second year. And two, they had several archaeology courses and degrees. So I thought my first year, I could take a few classes, meet a few professors, and get a feel for the profession and whether it's something that I would really want to be pursuing. And it was. Yeah. I loved the opportunities that I was able to seize in Hunter College and the professors and the mentors that I did acquire, I guess, during those 4 years.
Oh, that's so cool. That's awesome. That's interesting, the difference between what it is like in even between Canada, where I studied, and the US, where you studied. Because for me, similar to you, I had a fascination with the ancient world since I was like small. I think particularly ancient Egypt was like my bag. I was all about it. I tried to learn ancient Egyptian from watching the Mummy movies with Brendan Fraser. Like, that's how into it I was. And for me, when I was picking universities, I didn't necessarily know that I wanted to be an archaeologist. I knew that like history and English were kind of the two subjects that I excelled in. And I remember going into the guidance counselor's office, and she was showing me like different programs and talking to me about what I liked. And she pointed at the Laurier program, and it said archaeology that you can study. And I was like, oh, that, yes, that's what I want to do. 100%. But unlike your college, I went in, and from the first, you were studying for all 4 years, you had like a major, and you could have a minor if you wanted. I didn't end up with one. But yeah, it's interesting to see that difference.
For sure. When I ended up moving to Britain to do my master's, it was a bit of a shock to hear that my fellow cohort members had done archaeology their entire university career in Britain. Sort of, you have to choose going into university, which was a bit of a shock for me because I really like the American system of having your general requirements, right? Mm. Where you get to explore a little bit different aspects. And had I not had that opportunity, I wouldn't have realized that actually anthropology was also kind of my bag as well.
Yeah.
Hunter College has a classical archaeology department, which pretty much strictly focuses, obviously, on the Mediterranean, which was amazing. So I majored in that. But I was also really interested in the anthropology department because it really encompassed the things I loved. So languages, linguistics, we did a lot of linguistics, which is one of my favorite things in the world. We did cultural anthropology, we did physical anthropology, which I think here in Britain is called biological anthropology.
Yeah.
There was also an archaeology department within the anthropology major.
Yeah.
So I was able to do that. And it was actually through the anthropology department that I got most of my opportunities, all of my opportunities actually for field schools during my undergraduate career.
Yeah, I think that's very common in the US and is something that I think is very particular to the US. I get a lot of questions on the channel from people asking about, oh, I can't find an archaeology program. There's only anthropology available. And then I try wherever I can to let them know that it's not that they don't offer archaeology, it's that it's often within the anthropology department. And sometimes it's you'll get a degree in anthropology and a specialism in archaeology rather than you have to look for a completely separate archaeology program. And it's not like those don't exist in the US, but I think the trend is more that they're very integrated into the anthropology department rather than standing on their own. Yeah.
And what I found as well was that the archaeology within the anthropology department was more focused on Mesoamerican archaeology. Mm-hmm. So I felt I had a really good balance of sort of like learning about the ancient world in Europe, but also learning about the ancient world in the Americas, basically. Mm-hmm. Also, it was through the anthropology department that I realized that really my interest within archaeology, because archaeology really is a very broad sort of field, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah.
There's so many subspecialties. And it was actually through the anthropology department that I discovered so many different options and that my real interest lie in bioarchaeology, mm-hmm. specifically human osteology, human bones. And it was actually through that contact that I was able to sort of refine my interest.
Well, that's actually a good lead into our next question, which is, why did you decide to come to the UK to study for your master's? What made you pick Sheffield University in particular?
So once I realized that human osteology was my interest, I began looking into what my graduate options were. And in the States, the focus seemed much more on paleoanthropology rather than sort of like historical remains of our human ancestors. I wasn't convinced that that's what I wanted to do a PhD on. Mm-hmm. And that's a big commitment of, you know, possibly 8 years if that wasn't something that I was sure about. It was actually in one of the field schools I participated in Iceland that I met two people who were actually doing human osteology courses in Britain at the time. One of them was doing it in Sheffield and the other one was doing it in UCL in London. And that kind of sparked an idea for me. Being a European citizen, I understood that studying in Europe was an option for me. I actually kind of forgot that that was an option for me. And I thought, well, it's a 12-month degree in human osteology. I can go do it, see if that's what I want to do. That's really my interest. Mm-hmm. If it isn't, well, I've not really lost anything because it's 12 months and I still have a master's of science out of it.
Yeah, you still get something.
Exactly. So it's not like a year wasted at all. It was actually through talking to my field school mates, mm-hmm. that I began doing research into different universities in Britain. And also with the understanding that Britain has really good human osteology programs.
Tell us a bit more about like Sheffield. What made you choose it? What was it like living there? What were the professors like? Did you find that the school like lived up to your expectations?
I think after being in New York City, I did want a change, a complete different change of pace, a change of scenery. So I did consider UCL, but I did visit both UCL and Sheffield before I made my decision. Oh, and I met with the professors, the directors of each program. They were all lovely, but I felt walking around in London just felt like that same sort of vibe as New York City.
Yeah.
And that's not exactly what I was going for. I think I wanted a complete change of pace. And I went to Sheffield and everyone was really friendly. And I could see hills in the background of the major city. And it just felt like that the right vibe that I was going for.
Yeah.
I actually thought that moving to Sheffield might be a huge sort of culture shock because going from New York City, being so vibrant, having so many things to do, that the slower pace of life in Sheffield would affect me in some way.
Mm-hmm.
But actually, it turns out Sheffield is an incredibly vibrant city. It's a university town. Mm-hmm. It has two universities, Hallam University and the University of Sheffield. So there's always things going on. It's a great scene for music. And it has that access to nature that I was really looking for.
Yeah.
It's bustling, but also quite serene. And I love that about Sheffield.
Yeah.
It has a very special place in my heart.
I've actually taken a zoo archaeology like short course at Sheffield. Again, like we're so similar because one of the reasons I chose to go to the UK was because I was like, okay, I need a different change of scene from Waterloo. Like I need to get out of my comfort zone here. I applied for several different universities in the UK. Edinburgh was always my top choice. I emailed the schools rather than being able to visit. And one of the reasons I chose Edinburgh was because I was like, I want to live in Scotland. My last name is Scottish and my dad's super into like our Scottish heritage. So I was like, oh, it would be nice to go live in Scotland for a year. And similar to you, even if it was just going to be a year, it's not the same as that big commitment that you need for a PhD.
And that's an interesting point because I would add that doing a master's in the States wasn't something that I considered at all. I think if I had stayed in the States, it would have been PhD. A master's degree in the United States is very expensive and very time consuming.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas not that it isn't as intense in Britain, but in Britain it's condensed into 12 months.
Yeah.
And I feel like it's less of a lifelong commitment.
Yeah, it was the same for me. In Canada, they're usually 2 years. And I think in the US, I don't know if it's always the case, but are they not usually attached to a PhD? So it's like you spend
sometimes,
the first bit doing a master's, and then once you finish that bit, you then move on to the PhD without having to like reapply. Whereas here, they're usually very separate.
Yep.
I still don't entirely understand the UK system because here they typically go to school for 3 years, but if they go for four, then that means that they have an undergrad and a master's. It's not entirely separate or the same as like the programs that you and I would have gone to. Like, I don't think there were any fourth year archaeology students in my program at Edinburgh.
That was actually the difference in the undergraduate careers between the States and Britain was a huge shock to me because here it's 3 years and the first year doesn't count towards your final grade.
Yeah.
Which coming from the American system, where it's like every single class you take has an impact on your overall GPA, that was very shocking to me.
I'm the same. I entirely, everything counted towards what my end qualifying degree for my future academic career was going to be. Once you finished your master's, you decided that you weren't going to go for a PhD and you decided to enter professional/commercial archaeology instead. So what kind of made you decide to follow that route and what was it like?
So my intention had always been to do a PhD straight after my master's, or that's what I thought before I did my master's.
Yeah.
I actually didn't feel like the timing was right to do a PhD right after my master's, especially because you had to apply within like 4 months of starting your master's. And I just wasn't in the right frame of mind to, I mean, I had to finish my master's first, let alone think of a PhD project. And I actually genuinely did want to start working.
Yeah, no, I'm the same. I was like, you know what? I've spent enough time in school. I want to start actually making money instead of like just giving it to people. And it's also kind of one of those things as well where I think people, not that I ever really have considered it, but just because you don't want to do a PhD right after a master's degree doesn't mean that automatically you'll never ever be able to go and get one at a later date. There are people
Absolutely.
Who go and work and then later on they're like, oh, maybe this is actually something I want to do more in terms of getting a PhD, or they find a project or an opportunity that suits them. The door is never closed on that just because you didn't go straight from undergrad all the way to PhD and spent a decade in school.
And I think that's also like a really important point to remind people. It's okay to sort of reassess your goal, you know, mm-hmm. along the way, and especially archaeology, there is no set path. There is no right way of having a career in archaeology. There's a freedom to it, but equally, I think it can be somewhat scary in that there isn't anyone to tell you this is what you need to do next to get to this particular goal. I actually did want to start working, and Sheffield turned out to be a really good decision because there is a major commercial archaeology unit based in Sheffield. And when I got my first contract for that company, that was a dream come true. I mean, going from that little girl who was dreaming about the ancient world and was told at several stages, you know, archaeology is not very lucrative, which isn't wrong. It's not lucrative and you're going to be limiting your career options. And which, again, it's not untrue, but I was very determined, and this was my passion, and I was going to make it work no matter what. Mm-hmm. So for me, getting that job was just, it was huge.
Were your parents very supportive of it? Because I know my mom has said to me previously that when she tells or would tell people that I'm working as an archaeologist or I'm studying archaeologists at university, she would sometimes get people being like, oh, well, why are you letting her do that? She'll never make money at it, et cetera. And my mom was just kind of like, yeah, but she like loves it, and that's what she wants to do. And I want her to do something that she wants to do. Like, I'm absolutely horrible at math. She wasn't going to force me to like go and be an accountant or work in finance or work in business or something where I just wasn't going to enjoy myself, because my parents did help me with paying for university, but they were always very supportive in terms of me wanting to pursue this career. So did you have the same experience from your parents?
I can understand sort of people seeing archaeology that way. So I think my dad was the one that needed a little bit more convincing, because I think it's a normal concern for a parent to want to make sure that their children are going to be well off, you know, be able to take care of themselves and support themselves financially. He had the most reservations. My mom was a bit more like, well, she's loved this her whole life, and she's always been very determined. So, you know, if she's happy, I'm happy. Not to say that my father wouldn't be happy with my happiness, but I think he wanted a bit more reassurance that I'd be able to support myself, you know, with university debt being the way it is in the States. You know, he had legitimate concerns.
Yeah.
And it wasn't until my second year of my undergrad, my sophomore year, I was awarded several fellowships and my tuition was waived and I got stipends, that he was like, okay, maybe this will be all right after
maybe
all.
Maybe this will work out.
Exactly. I think he admired my hustle and was a bit more reassured that I would be able to make it work somehow.
Yeah. Oh, that's good. Well, I'm glad that he was reassured by that. So you decided to go into commercial archaeology, and like you said, you got this contract from a major unit in Sheffield. What was your first project like? What was it like working for them?
So my first project with them was completely the sort of project that I needed to not get used to, because it was magical.
I was the same. You go and then I'll go.
So it was July. It was on the Suffolk coast. The weather was perfect. The natural was the sandy silt. The natural and the features were really distinct. It was perfect.
Yeah.
We were staying in this beautiful thatched roof cottage. And I was like, is this what this is always like? And my coworkers were like, do not get used to this. This is not what it's normally like.
Yeah. That's crazy. Mine was actually for a very small unit in Edinburgh. And how I got the job was like entirely through word of mouth and not through like job applications or anything. But it was actually at a site that was about a 2-minute walk from my apartment. I started off being able to like walk to work. And if I wanted to, I could have gone home for lunch every day. My commute was really small. It was in February in Edinburgh, so it was a bit dreary every day. But at the same time, like the fact that if it was cold or whatever, like I would just be able, I would be home and I would just be able to take a hot shower right after. Like it didn't
concern. Amazing.
Yeah. And like you, I was just like, oh my gosh, I'm getting paid to do this. Previously, I've just had to pay people so much money for the privilege of being able to go and do this. And now I'm actually getting paid. This is amazing. And it was pretty good. And I worked with like a really great team as well, that they knew it was my first job. The person I was working with most directly every day, he was also a Canadian who had come over here and started working. So he was super supportive. And he knew that even though I knew how to do archaeology, I had no idea how the system worked over here. So they were really good about being understanding and explaining things to me and how things are done over here, because it was very different than what I had gone through at field school. Like I still had the underlying skills, but just the way that they do things and what they call things and their terminology is just different. So tell us a bit more about what your experience was. What was it like? You spent 5 years doing it. So clearly it was, you liked it enough to continue doing it, and not after you discovered that your dream dig wasn't the norm. You weren't like, this isn't for me anymore.
So I spent 2 years working in England, and then the other three were in Wales. Mm-hmm. The two in England were, I think, more representative of what commercial archaeology is like. So any given week, I could be sent on different sites across the country. It's important to remember that it's really taxing. It can be really taxing. And mm-hmm. if that sort of lifestyle is sustainable to you, that's okay. You know, being in a different city, in a different site every week, or sometimes several times in a week, can be really fun. I saw parts of England that I wouldn't have seen otherwise.
Yeah.
And I was exposed to lots of different projects, lots of different types of archaeology, different types of sites. Mm-hmm. So it was a really valuable experience, but it's not for everybody. And I think it's important to remember that that's okay. Mm-hmm. And I think at the time of my life, I could, you know, I could do that. And it was fine. But I actually quite preferred my time in Wales, because I went home every single day of those 3 years. And the quality of life does increase. You are able to have hobbies. You're mm-hmm. able to have a social life. Mm-hmm. You're able to cook your own meals.
Definitely the same. I think that's also very much, I've noticed that's very related to age. Mm-hmm. People, when they graduate, they're happy to travel. They probably don't have a long-term partner. It's much easier for them to travel all over the country and et cetera. But the older you get and you start to want to maybe settle down a bit more, you want to, if you're not dating an archaeologist, which I find is tends to not be the norm, we are incredibly inbred as a discipline in my experience, but you actually want to see that person. And if you're not working with them, you only get to see them like 2 days a week and on Skype calls, which can be really difficult. One thing I also wanted to ask you is, did you ever consider going back to the US and working, or did you always know that you wanted to stay, or like what made you decide, okay, well, I want to give this a go in the UK?
The type of archaeology here, I knew that there'd be really interesting archaeology, or not just interesting, but the type of archaeology that would keep me really engaged.
Yeah.
And I have had friends tell me that sort of like CRM, which is the equivalent in the States of commercial mm-hmm. archaeology, isn't necessarily all that fun. Seeing that I was here already, and I hadn't ruled out necessarily doing a PhD, so I didn't necessarily want to go back and then sort of flip-flop between countries. And I liked the opportunities that I was getting here to develop myself as a professional, as an archaeologist. Mm-hmm. And my goal really was to be as well-rounded an archaeologist as I possibly could be. Mm-hmm. And because I'd gotten some momentum here and I was getting to know people, like you were saying, within archaeology, sometimes you get hired because someone knew you, right?
Yes, very much.
Interviewing isn't a huge thing in the commercial industry.
like, as much as it probably shouldn't be that way, it is very much, I find, a combination of luck, sheer luck, that they happen to see your resume when they need people, and word of mouth. So if you know someone who's working at a company and they're on a project and they've all of a sudden they need to hire 10 people, and they'll be like, oh, look, my company's hiring. I can give you your CV to my project manager and I can vouch for you and tell them you're good, kind of thing, is something that like definitely has happened to me. And I is something that I've done for other people as well.
Same, absolutely the same. The job in Wales, I heard through a friend who'd heard through a friend that they needed osteologists, and I was like, well, I'm one of those.
Well, that's really exciting. So you've actually worked as an osteologist on an archaeological project, which I want to definitely hear more about, because that is something that like nobody with an osteology degree tends to get to do, which is unfortunate because I think it's a very, very popular master's in the UK, especially for international students. I think is then leads to sometimes to resentment that people pay a lot of money for those degrees, and then they actually find out that those jobs are exceedingly rare and very competitive. If you can tell me a bit more about your Welsh job and then working as an osteoarchaeologist and how that came about, that would be great.
It's so true what you say. I actually had excavated more human remains before doing my master's than sort of like immediately after getting my qualification, which was pretty frustrating because that was my interest. That's what I wanted to develop more. It was amazing, the sort of projects in Wales. I actually ended up working in three major cemeteries, which was so good, so interesting. So lucky, really. First of the three had actually the best bone preservation. The other ones were sort hit or miss a little bit. But the first one made everything worth it. It was a really interesting cemetery. It wasn't supposed to be there. which they're always the best. The surprise ones. And it was fantastic. I felt so fulfilled, right? Mm-hmm. Being paid to be an archaeologist, doing exactly what I studied. Mm-hmm. And those moments are so rare, right? Mm-hmm. Sites can be so disappointing in many ways, right?
Yeah.
When all you've got are crisscrossing ditches and there's not much left. Getting to work in a site with really interesting archaeology is always feels like a treat. And
I think that's something that surprises a lot of people. I think they think that archaeology is something that like is super exciting all the time.
Mm.
And I think the opposite is actually quite true. Not that it's necessarily boring, but it's not nearly as exciting as people expect. And what people think of as an archaeological site, at least in my mind, is always shaped by these like movies and video games where you see these like vast underground caverns or big ruins or everything. And then you show up on a site and it's like dirt with slightly different colored dirt in circles and lines. People are like, oh, this is a bit underwhelming.
Yeah.
is this what am I supposed to learn from this? What is this?
Exactly. Where's all the adventure and the thrilling sort of heroics? Research digs can be like that, but for the most part, commercial archaeology is not like that at all.
You can get very interesting sites, but then you also have boring sites where there's not a lot going on, and what is going on is like, okay, there's a couple ditches here and maybe some post holes and there's no finds. And that's not to say that's not important or that it shouldn't, that because of that it shouldn't be investigated, but not every site is going to be absolutely groundbreaking and amazing. And we're just there to try and make sure that it's at least recorded, because you don't want to have that bias where you're only looking at the exciting stuff. The boring stuff has equally important information to tell us also.
And that's why when people ask sometimes, it's like, oh, well, what's the most exciting thing that you found? It's like, well, my definition of really exciting, it's probably really different to yours, right? Yeah. Because I think people assume it's always going to be some kind of jewelry or a weapon. But actually finding like a really well-preserved wall or flooring can actually be really exciting and really satisfying to excavate.
Yeah, exactly.
And it's not any less important or significant.
That is kind of, I think, a big misconception about archaeology, is that it's only worth looking at if it actually has some kind of value or monetary value attached to it. Whereas archaeologists, we look at the value of the knowledge that is going to be able to give us about what we know about the past, which is a big place where we don't intersect with the public.
and of course, and I think it's so important to find ways in which to communicate that, because sometimes people will look at an object and be really excited about that, but what we're interested in is understanding what context that came out of and what that tells us about the object, the people. And we need to find better ways of communicating. It's not just the monetary value you attach to an object, but it's its historic and scientific value.
So like you said, you spent 5 years doing this, and then you recently made the transition to working for the British Museum. Congratulations.
Thank you.
So what made you decide, or what prompted you to move away from working in commercial, developer-led, professional archaeology, et cetera, into going into a museum, which is a completely different kind of environment?
So actually, when I was an undergraduate, I was an intern for 2 years at the American Museum of Natural History.
Oh, okay.
And those were two of the best years of my life. Working in that environment kind of set the bar of what I wanted my future to look like. Ultimately, I wanted to work in museums. Mm-hmm. And I know that I've done kind of like a roundabout way of getting there. Mm-hmm. But that's what I meant earlier as well, is that there is no set path within heritage or museums and archaeology. Even though I did commercial archaeology for 5 years, I always thought that that was sort of preparing myself as a professional to really gather the knowledge that I would need in order to move on to a different aspect of my career. I did never consider doing commercial archaeology for like a decade, because like we were mentioning before, it's not necessarily sustainable. And I like my hobbies. I quite like martial arts, and I can't commit to martial arts, for example, the way I would, because, well, say I got injured, that would actually affect my ability to do my job. Say like I sprained my wrist, I wouldn't be able to travel, right?
Yeah.
So these are things that I had to consider and sort of like balance out in my life. The idea of going back to a museum was always
in your plan. Like,
yes, kind of. Absolutely.
So how did you then end up at the British Museum? Did you see a job advert, or was it like a word of mouth thing?
So it was actually the way I think the real world tends to work. I saw the application and I applied for it, and I was so excited about the opportunity, because reading the job description, I was really confident that actually these are things that I'd done in commercial archaeology before. The role is about rationalizing an archive, basically.
Okay.
And that's something that I actually had a lot of experience with, having done that very same thing with the commercial archaeology unit that I worked with in Wales. The unit that I worked with in England is one of the top units. So it's very vast, and they've got specialists for everything, right? So if you're an environmental specialist, you do that. If you're built heritage, you do that. So there isn't a lot of movement if you're a field archaeologist to get experience with these different aspects, which it was a good thing, because it meant that I got a lot of experience as a field archaeologist, all the different aspects of that. But the Welsh unit is much smaller, which meant that I had a lot of scope to learn different skills. Mm-hmm. So they didn't necessarily have a post-dec specialist, so I was able to step up and do a lot of those roles and really learn. I was able to do environmental sampling, like processing. Mm-hmm. So it was such a valuable experience. In those 3 years in Wales, I think I got experience that, you know, worth a lot longer than those 3 years. I really value it, because it helped me in my goal to become that, you know, really well-rounded archaeologist. Mm-hmm. But it also built my confidence as an archaeologist, which I think is something that archaeologists struggle with. Mm-hmm. I think archaeologists have a hard time realizing that we have a huge set of transferable skills. Mm-hmm. And I know that it's sometimes really difficult to visualize yourself doing another kind of job, because archaeology is so specific.
What were the qualifications and strengths that you feel that you had when applying for the job at the British Museum that you think like led to you being the winning candidate, especially since I think the impression a lot of the time is that if you don't have a museum-related qualification, you shouldn't even bother, especially because museums are very competitive.
Well, I think that's why I was super excited about this particular job advert, is they wanted people with archaeological experience, because the role entails rationalizing archaeological archives. And whereas people with museum studies might know how to do the rationalizing of archives in general, not all of this material had preliminary post-decs done to it yet. So it would require an archaeologist with that sort of understanding of being able to read archive material and making connections between sort of decisions that had been made. It was an opportunity I knew that I couldn't pass up on, because it's I felt like it's a one-in-a-lifetime sort of opportunity. And I do have the right qualifications, and they were specifically looking for archaeologists. Mm-hmm. So I know it's very difficult in the UK to move from archaeology to museums. I don't think it's quite the same in the United States. I have friends from my undergraduate career who also did archaeology with me and were able to move into museums because it's understood that they have the required standing of the material and collection. So I was a bit surprised that it was so difficult in Britain to make that transition.
Mm-hmm. But you did. And congratulations.
Well done. Thank you. Thank
you. You only just started working at the British Museum before coronavirus, so you can't speak too much about what your job is yet. But like, have you enjoyed it? What does it feel like to be able to say that you work for the British Museum?
It's an absolute dream come true. I remember Skyping with my parents, I think the weekend before my first day. And it just felt so surreal that, you know, it's one of those moments, like my first time signing a contract with a commercial unit, where it's like thinking of me being a little girl dreaming about the ancient world to starting employment with the British Museum is absolutely wild. But I think perhaps a testament to what you can achieve if you or what you can accomplish when you are really stubborn.
yeah exactly. And also kind of not adopting a negative outlook to things, like, oh, that job, I would love that job, but I'll never get it, so like I'm not going to bother applying, because you know, the worst thing that can happen is they say no.
And I have applied to lots of jobs and not heard back, you know, in jobs that I truly felt I could undertake and I could thrive in. Mm-hmm. So it's really hard not to be discouraged by that. Not to brush off how hard it's been as well.
Yeah.
It's you know, commercial archaeology is not an easy field to be in. And mm-hmm. I think sometimes people forget that we're out there in all weather.
Oh, yes.
we're no matter how cold, how windy, how hot, you know, we're still out there. And it's very taxing on your body.
Yeah, it's very similar. It is essentially like a construction job. You really have to be in particular conditions for it to get called off. And that doesn't happen very often. No. So you just have to slog it through. I know that I was really surprised once when I had to do a walkover in the Highlands with thunder snowstorms. And I was like doing a walkover in the Highlands and there was like at least this much snow on the ground. And I was just kind of looking at the person I was with being like, how are we going to see anything in this? Like, I'm not trying to be a wimp, but really?
Like, I've had so many of those moments, particularly Wales can be really windy. And I remember years ago now, a site, and I was like, we're still out here. Like, that Ferris Henson is twisted right now. It's like, we're still out here. How is this possible?
Yeah. How are we actually getting anything constructive done right now? Like, is this like, you know, because it is a business. So if they can charge for your time on site until the last possible moment, they will, because the point of a business is to make money. And that's not necessarily a bad thing as long as, you know, people's safety is respected. But it's definitely a thing. I think I'm very much sometimes a badge of honor for archaeologists to be like, oh yeah, I've worked through this. It says a lot about our dedication to our work and how we feel about it. What is your best and worst field experiences?
Best, hands down, my second summer in Iceland. It was everything that you dream an excavation to be. The archaeology was interesting. The team was stellar. The scenery was amazing. It was just, everything was perfect. And that was actually the first time I excavated in a cemetery. So it was quite significant. And Iceland and the people that I met on that team also have a really special place in my heart for me. Aww. The worst, probably getting bitten by fire ants in Antigua and Barbuda.
Oh, God.
You see, when the people think it's all like adventure, that's probably like the closest I've ever been to that more adventurous side of
like Indiana Jones, like Tomb Raider setting.
Yeah, absolutely. That was the closest one for sure.
What is your favorite thing that you've ever found or discovered on an archaeological site?
Probably going back to that site in Iceland. I was excavating on a corner of the site. I was just cleaning an area a little bit, and it was a dump of ash. There shouldn't have been anything in it, but I was really surprised to find a bronze brooch. And ooh. I was really excited about that because it's always fun when, you know, it's not expected, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And that's one of my favorite.
What is it like working as a minority in such a white-dominated field? Are there any particular instances or experiences that stand out to you that you want to highlight or comment on?
I think isolating would be the best way to describe it. And I think this applies to any kind of minority in any kind of sort of work environment.
Mm-hmm.
There was an instance in a previous project that I worked on a couple of years ago in which I was sort of the target of a racially motivated incident. So okay. To be honest, the incident itself wasn't particularly traumatic. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, I am quite used to being the recipient of sort of micro and macro aggressions.
Mm-hmm.
And I have learned to sort of cope with those in various ways. What was actually more traumatic than the incident itself was the response to it from colleagues during that project. So actually, there's a lot of discussion at the moment with regards to how effective unconscious bias training is in different workplaces. But when we consider the origins of archaeology being sort of like the pastime of colonials and the legacy, the pervasive legacy that has, I think it's almost the responsibility of archaeologists to really interrogate how that manifests, right?
Yeah.
Whether it's in how communities are chosen for particular open days, right? Or which schools are chosen for open days. And there's also a lot of discussion at the moment about diversifying staff, right?
Mm-hmm.
So diversity of thought, of ability, of background, right?
Mm-hmm.
Which is all good, right? I think every workplace would benefit from people with different views and opinions. But I think what's really important as well with regards to, say, like this unconscious bias training is that I think the goal shouldn't just be to hire diverse staff, but also to retain that staff. Right?
Yeah, yeah.
And if you're not creating a culture in which that staff feels safe and comfortable to voice different opinions or feel supported when a racially motivated incident happens, there is no point then in hiring that staff in the first place.
Yeah, it's like it's a token. It becomes like a token gesture of, oh, look, we made a diverse hire. Look at us,
right?
You know,
right.
Give us our kudos. But then they just like leave that person in the background and they don't support them when it's actually needed. In general, archaeology has a retention problem, but I think it's definitely something that's probably amplified for minorities because of the reasons that you've talked about, and also I think. I don't know how much of an effect it has, but especially in commercial archaeology, the correlation between the fact that you're on a construction site and what kind of effect that has to attitudes and the way that people behave in some ways, because I know personally, my language goes down the absolute toilet when I'm on a construction site, and I can actually notice a difference. And that's very much something that is influenced by the people that I'm around and the environment I'm in. And I wonder if there's a similar thing happening with some of the stuff that you were talking about with like racially motivated incidents and stuff and that relation to the culture of the construction site.
Absolutely. And I think we can see it in terms of how women are treated on site. And that's sort of made, there's been a lot of progress made, right? In sort of curbing misogynistic language on site, right?
Yeah.
And calling people out for particular sort of jokes that are just seen as banter, right? This idea of banter that makes everything seem okay, and it really isn't.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd really like to point or highlight that unconscious bias training would be like an initial step. It's not like the answer to everything. It's like an initial step to raise awareness, just even if some of those previous colleagues during that time had even had a slight inkling as to how their response was sort of affecting me and even my own mental health. And mental health is actually, thankfully, also a subject that's gaining a lot of momentum. And there's a lot of talk about it and how you know, being on site and traveling all the time and being on deployment affects people. I mean, I remain hopeful as ever that these sorts of conversations will improve conditions. And archaeology really generally has a responsibility to interrogate sort of its own legacy and interrogate what kind of culture it fosters within its unit. If they genuinely have a commitment to diversify their workplace, and it shouldn't just be about sort of ethnic backgrounds, but it should be all kinds of diversity of thought and experience. Mm-hmm. They need to understand what sort of work culture they're going to be exposing people to. Will it be a traumatic experience?
I have my own bitterness related to archaeological workplace culture and the way that things have been propagated for a long time. Sure. And sometimes the impression that you can get that they're just paying lip service to what they need to rather than making actual steps, but also recognizing the fact that cultural changes like that are unfortunately slow. They're not something that's going to happen overnight. And like you said, things like unconscious bias training, supporting your staff when these things happen, having processes in place so that there's actually like a system to follow and people know what to do when these things happen are all steps, but they're not individual things that are going to fix the entire problem. And it's something that we continually need to work on and work towards and assess how we're doing and what improvements need to be made.
So it's actually been quite interesting because in the 8 years that I've been involved in archaeology in Britain, there's only one other non-white archaeologist that I've met. And it's actually been a question that I've been asking colleagues and friends quite regularly now as to, well, in your career, you know, how many non-white archaeologists have you met? And, you know, after pausing and thinking for a bit, they're like, one. I'm like, is it me? and normally they say yes. Even though 2020 has been, you know, turbulent, traumatic time, it's actually opened up quite exciting opportunities as well. Even just like having these kinds of conversations wouldn't necessarily have been something that occurred to us before, even though the technology was there. So a group of archaeologists or heritage professionals in the UK, non-white archaeologists, we have actually sort of found each other, and we're trying to put together a group still in its early stages. Watch this space for sure. We're still developing our mission and our goals, but we hope to create a space, create visibility for non-white archaeologists and create a forum where we can discuss some of these issues and sort of also provide support for each other. And it'd be really exciting to talk about that in the future.
Yeah. Oh, I really hope that I get to have you and the rest of your colleagues in that group. Hopefully someday we can have a video about it and shout about it from the rooftop so like everybody can see all the amazing and cool stuff that's happening. So last question, what would you say to encourage and inspire other people who are looking to enter archaeology to follow in your footsteps?
I think one of the most important things would be to surround yourself with people who believe in your goals and your dreams, and perhaps also find a mentor in archaeology, because there is no one set path in which to have a career in archaeology. There isn't a formula. You could do all kinds of different, you know, twists and turns and still have a very fulfilling career. So, but just having someone to remind you of that is can be good. And also what I'd like to say, if you're a budding non-white archaeologist, that there is room for you in this field, and and I think you're very sorely needed. Your perspective, your experience, and that goes for archaeology, heritage, museums. There's definitely space for you.
That's awesome. Great answers. Thank you so much for coming onto my channel. It's been a real pleasure getting to talk to you today and to hear your story. It's really, really interesting. And I think a lot of people that watch this channel will agree with me. And it's been really lovely to get to know you while we've been arranging all this behind the scenes. And I really hope that I will be able to host yourself and other people from the group that you're talking about on this channel at some point in the future. And I'm really looking forward to seeing what you guys are going to do. So thank you for coming today.
Thank you for having me.
All right, so that was a long chat, guys. Thank you for persevering all the way to the end of this. I really enjoyed talking with Jeanette in this video today, and I'm so honored that she came onto my channel. We had not previously met before the whole process and setting up this video, and she really trusted me to be able to help convey her story in the way that she wanted. It was also very interesting for me personally, and I hope for you guys as well, to hear about just someone's different story, especially one that has gone in such an interesting direction in terms of going from a career in professional archaeology to working in somewhere as prestigious and cool as the British Museum. So I'm really excited to hopefully in future be able to catch up with her more and find out more about what her job at the British Museum is like, and also interviewing many other archaeologists in future for you guys. This is stuff that I really want to do more of on my channel, because while, you know, it's great to hear about me and my life, I think it's really important for you to see the perspectives and the way things have gone for people all over archaeology, not just me. And I'm really excited to help bring these stories to you guys. So if you like this video, please give us a thumbs up. If you have any questions, comments, concerns, as per usual, please put them down in the comments below, and Jeanette and myself will do our best to answer them. If you'd like to follow Jeanette or myself on our archaeological journeys, then our social media is linked down below for you guys. Thank you so much, guys, for watching, and I'll see you next time. Bye!